Well, good day, and welcome back to my YouTube channel. Quite a warm day here on a Thursday in Adelaide, but very pleasant. Today I'm going to just dive into a little bit of deeper thinking, or maybe not so deeper thinking, depending on how you view this. I thought I would pose the question, and this is the question I've got. I'm reading some of this off of the off my computer in front of me to give me so. Someone told me the other day that I've got short-term memory failure, so I've got some aids up here to help me remember everything. So my title today is What You Don't Need to Know to Take Good Photographs. By that I mean what you don't need to know to be an outstanding or a professional type photographer, if you just want to be an average person. An average photographer, what you don't need to know. There are heaps of photography tutorials on YouTube, and you can learn heaps. You can really take your photography to another level if you wish. But while all these things are all very interesting, and I look at heaps of them, heaps is a South Australian word, by the way, we're the main state that uses that phraseology. But while these things are all interesting, what does the average person need to know? What does the average person need to know without being seduced by all the ads and the how-tos available for us today? If you just want to take pics to share with your friends at a basic level, then what? How do we go about that? What do you need to know and what don't you need to know? Well, in my parents' day, the box brownie was in mass production. And many wonderful family memories were captured on it. There are lots of photos in our archives, in our collections, family collections, are all taken on the box brownie. If you don't know what that is, here's one, a similar one. This is a SX20 Brownie Junior, this one, but they're all pretty much the same as that. They had a roll of film in there and very basic tripping the shutter there and very little else that's all you had to do. There are lots of variations of them. This is another brand, wasn't a brownie one, a Kodak one, but another brand. And then also they had a little, this was the one of the first cameras that I used actually. This is a Brownie 127 camera, a little, I don't know what they call this one, a Brownie Junior, but basically you just wound the film on there, took the shot. That was it, pretty basic. And that's what the masses had back in my parents' day. And then of course, when I was a younger person growing up in the 1960s, those of us who were interested at all had a Kodak Instamatic. You'll find a copy of, or photos of three Kodak Instamatics on the banner above my YouTube channel there. You'll see what they look like. And those who were interested had those, and they had a little square photograph, and you could shoot slides and prints, colour or black and white, and that was all that most people wanted. Some of them were had a few adjustments on them, and that's all we used. Now the sky is the limit with what's available. So here is what I think you don't need to know to be a good photographer. I'm not saying to be a professional photographer, but you don't need to know these things, which people are very astute at teaching us these things on YouTube. You don't need to know the theory of light and colour. I have a basic understanding of it, but not a working knowledge of it. The photographic triangle. Now your camera, if it's an automatic type camera, or your phone, will probably work most of this out for you. The photographic triangle is the relationship between the shutter speed and the aperture of your lens, and the ISO, or the speed of your film, or how much light your sensor's letting in. And that's important if you want to go to higher levels to understand that, but at the basic level, your camera will probably work this out for you. Now, Photoshop and Lightroom, etc., the famous editing programs that a lot of people use all the time. If you're a serious photographer, you're probably familiar with Lightroom and Photoshop, and a few others. Now, your film lab, or basic computer photo editing that you have on your own computer, can be quite good without all the bells and whistles. as can the department stores that can print your photos and offer you basic in-house access to their editing equipment. How a light meter works. Your camera will probably do it by itself if you have a modern camera. You can get an app on your phone to work as an independent light meter if you wish. I have one on my phone, I don't use it very often, but you can download these independent, I'm just moving this up, you can download these apps, light meter apps, if you've got an old film camera that doesn't have a light meter built into it and you need to adjust the settings, well then the app that you can get will show you how to do that. You don't need to know how film works, the chemistry of it, the processing and the printing. That's if you were shooting film. And by the same token, you don't need to know how images are captured digitally, what sensors are and how they operate, what pixels are and all that stuff, all that technical digital stuff. You don't need to know that. So what do you need to know to have, or what do you need to have to take good photographs? So here's a little bit of a list I'll give you. A working film or a digital camera or a good phone camera with some automatic settings is pretty good to have to take some good basic photos. And the other main thing you need is a good eye for composition and what constitutes a good photograph to you in your eyes. Just because someone else doesn't like your photo doesn't mean that you don't like it, and it means something to you. And more importantly, it usually evokes a memory that you had when you were taking it. Now, some things that are helpful to take good photographs, these are some things you might want to ponder. And I teach this particular one when people come to me when they're about to go overseas and they've got a little compact camera. And I say, look, this is the most important thing you can remember and know how to use with your little pop-up flash on your camera. Understanding when a photo is backlit and some adjustment might be needed. Sometimes you've got a picture of a person, like you're looking at me here, but I might be outside and I might have a very bright white sky behind me. And that's going to lie to your camera's meter, whatever one you're using. So you're going to have to pop a little bit of flash into the front so that my face is exposed nicely. At the moment, exposed nicely because it's an even lighting situation in here and there's no bright background. And the phone camera I'm using is compensating for that. And as I said, how to use, when you're in that situation, particularly when people go on their holidays overseas, whether they're using a film camera or a digital camera, how to use a simple flash, quite often just a little pop-up flash, to make your photos expose properly. And you can also use other light sources to fill flash. You can reflect light off of a piece of foam or an umbrella or off of a wall or using a flash. And another thing that's helpful is a steady hand or tripod. A lot of cameras these days have inbuilt camera shake compensation. So, and I work with a whole lot of people, or I'm involved with a photographic group that have Parkinson's disease, and they have the shakes, but they can get round what's happening with that with modern cameras and also using a tripod. So, what else? A computer is mainly essential these days, but you can sidestep this if you use your local camera lab or a retail store camera lab, like the big retail stores. Like in Australia, we have the big Harvey Norman stores and Officeworks, and they have all these, and Woolworths, they have terrific in-house camera and photographic sections where you can go and have your photos printed, and you can use their equipment to edit, do some basic editing of your photos if you wish, and then have them printed. So, what is helpful to know to go to another level? We'll just go up here a bit. So the relationship between ISO, that used to be called the film speed, now it's the rating of how much light your sensor can let in at different settings, how sensitive your sensor in your digital camera is. So the relationship between that ISO and shutter speed, that's how quickly the shutter opens and closes on your camera, and the aperture setting, how big the setting is, whether it's a big open aperture or a closed one, how those three things work together. And we need to know if we are wanting to learn about photography and go to another level, we need to have a basic understanding of what that photographic triangle is, what it's called. And some people call it the photographic Holy Trinity, because there's three things that are interacting. And another thing that's useful to know is, I think I just touched on before, but it's how to bounce and reflect a light source. Sometimes if you're using a flash and you're just looking straight at someone and shoot the flash straight at them, you'll get harsh shadows. But if you bounce the flash off the ceiling, you'll get a lot softer light. Or if you bounce it off the wall sideways, or if you use a reflector, or even sometimes when someone's taking a photo with their phone camera, you can get someone else to stand alongside your face just here with another phone and turn on the flashlight on the phone and shine that on your face, and that'll help illuminate some of the shadows. So that's how to bounce and reflect a light source. Now I'm going to come into some philosophical things to ponder. Sorry about that, but I tend to do that on this channel, as you've probably gathered. As long as I understand how the basics can be applied, I don't need to know the science behind them. I just know how to creatively use those basics. I don't fully understand. I understand the basics of the triangle, the photographic triangle, and how they interact together. I don't know why they do that, but I know enough to create nice photographs. Now, Isaac Newton is considered one of the main founders of colour theory. But then if you have an inquiring mind, you say to yourself, and I'm going to put a link to a very interesting YouTube video that I discovered through one of my new subscribers explaining all about colour theory, which you might find interesting if you want to get into the real technical stuff. So Isaac Newton is considered one of the main founders of colour theory, but then, if you have an inquiring mind, I like to think the people that watch my channel have an inquiring mind. Where did light and colour from? Where did light and colour come from in the first place? Did it just appear? Was it always in the universe? Do you need the answers to know the answers to these questions to be a good photographer? Well, the answer is a resounding no. You don't need to know. Excuse me. Do you need to know, however, do you need to know the origin of these things for your ultimate life satisfaction? I think yes. Some might think doesn't matter. What do you think? As I said before, the photographic triangle is sometimes called the Holy Trinity of photography. So maybe the actual Holy Trinity is behind all of this. You'll have to think about that. So once again, thanks for watching. Like if you like. If you really dislike this, let me know. And I'll see you next time. Take care.